Yes, is the slide visible? Anyone? Yes, anyone? Is the slide visible?
Sir.
Okay, so we have already seen regarding the plastic analysis, and we had already seen how to calculate the value of shape factor, which is a very important parameter, which gives you the idea regarding how much the amount of load or how much amount of stress it can take beyond its elastic limit. Remember that, okay? Beyond elastic limit, what will be the extent of stresses it can take? For example, for a rectangular section, it is 1.5, which means that 50% more extra stresses it can take after elastic limit. That is what it meant. So that things we have already seen, and we have derived shape factor for three of the main section. That is, one is a rectangular section, one is a circular section, and a triangular section. Okay, in today's session we are going to solve problems regarding the I section as well as T section, and hope I you people have a calci and a book ready with you, because you are also going to solve with me today these problems. Okay, so before going into that, few concept regarding the plastic analysis I'm going to explain. So in plastic analysis, the plastic hinge definition, okay, a plastic hinge is a zone of yielding. Remember that, what happens in the plastic zone? So this is how the stress variations looks like, right? So all the fiber, okay, all the members, if you want to say, in the section has yielded, okay? So a plastic hinge is a zone of yielding. So see here, all these sections from here to from the end fiber till the neutral axis, from the end fiber till the neutral axis, the is been yielded due to flexure in the structural member. It might be due to flexure. Now we are considering the beam, so it is in the flexure, okay, in the structural member. Although hinges do not actually form, so in the, as I mentioned earlier in the previous session also, don't think that these hinges are formed and you can visibly see it, okay? Actually it won't be formed. It can be seen through a large change in slope occurring over the small lens. So as I showed in the previous session also, hope you remember that, okay? So if I consider this, what will happen? There will be something like this. This is the hinge. So for a small length, there will be some twistings. Okay, so that is the what we can see in a steel, but we cannot see the in a practical case, because for a small length, now this is a big length, you can identify this is the twisting is happening here. But in few cases, it won't be visible in a steel section. Okay, so in small locations, there will be something like this twisting is happening, which means the indicates that it has completely yielded at that point. Okay, so that is the meaning of that. So slide visible? Yes, anyone, is the slide visible? If it is not visible, and then if I'm going on explaining, let me know. Is it visible, right? Yes, anyone, is the slide visible or not?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so it can be a larger change of slope occurring over a small length. For a small length only, there will be a larger change in slope. That is what I've shown just now. Okay, there will be a twisting which will be taking place at some location and the position of maximum moment. So where there will be a maximum moment. So for a simply supported beam, okay, and a UDL is acting, okay, so the maximum load will be at the center. So your hinge will be formed at this location where there is a maximum bending moment which is acting. A strain hardening action usually occurs at these hinges, so that large deflection are accompanied by slightest increase in load. So what basically happens is that whenever there is a hinge is formed, there will be a deflections which might occur in this region. Okay, in this region. Now with this deflection will go on increasing if you just slightly increase the load. That is the main thing here. Okay, if you now increase the load after the formation of hinge, still if you go on increasing the load, what will happen? There will be a huge deflections. Remember that, larger deflection with the slightest increase in the load. A structure can be supported by computed ultimate load due to the formation of plastic hinges. So this is the main criteria at a critical section. Remember that a structure, till now we have seen regarding the elastic limit, right? So till the elastic limit we had designed. So in limit state we designed till here. But now if you go for this plastic hinge condition, then we can go for the this plastic state till here, okay, till the ultimate load, okay, due to the formation of plastic hinges. Now due to this formation of plastic hinges, what we can consider is we can consider till the ultimate load. Remember that the members remain elastic until the movement reaches MP. Remember that until the moment, so till the value, okay, the moment will be increasing, right? So until this M value, that is the moment, bending moment, till it reaches MP, so your section will be in still in elastic limit. Remember that once this value of moment will be equal to MP, that is the plastic moment, the maximum number of resistance, okay, elastic limit remain until the moment reaches MP. Once it reaches there, the maximum moment of resistance of a fully yield cross section, so after once it reaches MP, then the yielding of the member begins. So one by one the fibers become yielded. So first the end fiber will be yielded, so end fiber will reach FI. After that next fiber, like that till the neutral axis it will happen. Same thing from the downward direction. So this is the reason, okay? Any additional moment will cause the beam to rotate with a little increase in the stress. So remember that after once it, this type of stress distribution has occurred, after that there will be rotation, okay, with slightest increase in the stress. The rotation occurs at a constant moment of MP. So what is the moment? Constant moment will be equal to MP. Remember that, okay? So the zone acts as if it is a hinge. So remember that the zone, at this zone, whatever it might be here, as for a simply supported case with the UDL, it might be at the center. So that zone will act as a hinge, except a constant retaining moment MP. So with here, with the hinge, there will be a constant moment at this location. That is nothing but your MP. Remember that. So the plastic hinge, therefore, can be defined as a, so what do you mean by a plastic hinge? The proper definition is, can be defined as the yield zone due to flexure in a structure in which infinite rotation can be taken place at a constant retaining moment MP of the section. So remember that this is the definition, okay? So the plastic hinge. So the plastic hinge, therefore, can be defined as, so it is here, okay? I will highlight only that now, the definition. So the plastic hinge therefore can be defined as a yield zone. Remember that it is a yield zone. So complete section has a yield there now due to flexure. Okay, in a beams, it's a flexure condition. In a flexure, in a structure, remember that, in which infinite rotation can take place at a certain restraining moment MP of the section. So this is what it means by a plastic hinge. Okay, so this is the condition. So this is the definition. So if you've been asked in exam, define plastic hinge, this definition you people have to write. So a plastic hinge is represented by a black dot. So how do you represent that? So we have to represent that as a black dot. Remember that. So now what will be the hinge length now? So a few more things are there. Read this sentences, you will understand this. Now let me go to the one of the important condition, the hinge length. How to calculate this hinge length now? Okay, so consider a simply supported rectangular beam, okay, subject to a gradually increasing concentrated load P. So let us consider a concentrated load P which is acting at the center. A plastic hinge will be formed at the center. So remember where hinges are formed. So there are four regions where a hinge can form. One is under the loads. Remember that, under the loads, okay, under the point loads, sorry, under the point loads, okay, if you consider under the point loads, there will be a formation of hinge. Whenever there is a change in the dimensions, okay, dimensions, whenever there is a change in the dimension at that location, there might be hinge form. Whenever there is a maximum bending moment which might be occurring, remember that, and at these supports. So at these four locations, there is a probability of hinge formation, okay, under a point load. If the point load go on increases at this location, there might be a hinge formation. Whenever there is a change
in the dimension. So if this is one type, and again there is a change in dimension like this, okay, in this location at this junction, we can say there can be a formation of hinge. Okay, whenever there is a maximum bending moment, okay, for a simply supported case, it is at the center. So like that, in the supports due to shear force, okay. So in all this location, we can see that there might be a formation of hinges. Remember that. Now let us see what will be the hinge length for this case with the point load. Okay, so this is the section now with the span length of L. So at the center, there is a point load which is acting, and there is a maximum probability that there will be hinge formed at this location. Why? Because we are constantly increasing the load P. Okay, so this is how the bending moment diagram looks like. So at this location, it has yielded. So that's why it is MP. Okay, now the yielding is going on, taking place in this directions, both the direction the yielding is going. That's why it is MY. Okay. Now here at this junction, it is in plastic moment state, whereas here it's still in the yielding only. Okay, and beyond here, this is in the elastic state. Okay, this is in the elastic state. Here also it is in the elastic state, whereas here it is in a plastic state. Remember that. So development of plastic hinge and the hinge length. So how will this x by 2 will go on varying? So what is your MP? MP will be equal to PL by 4. What is this P? P is nothing but the load. So how to get this MP? So for a bending moment, for a simply supported beam with a point load acting, so the maximum bending moment at the center, this value will be what? WL by 4. Okay, so that instead of W, what is given? The load is given as P, right? So it is PL by 4. Now what is the yield value? MY. So FY into Z. What is the Z section for a rectangular section, which you have already seen in the previous session? So that is BD square by 6. Okay, that is a plastic modulus, BD square by 6. So BD square by 6 is the values, that is a section modulus. Okay, so MY equal to FY into 1 by 6, this is taken outside, into 4 into this value they have substituted. Okay, so BH square by 4. So 4, 4 they have taken. So 4, 4 get cancelled. So you can do it. Remember that. Then 2 by 3. So this is 2. This is 3. Okay, 4, 4 they have taken common. FY into BH square by 4. So BH square by 4 is the plastic modulus. Okay, this is the section modulus. Remember that. This is the section modulus Z. This is plastic modulus ZP. Okay, remember the difference. So this is the section modulus BH square by 6, whereas ZP is the plastic modulus BH square by 4. So hope you remember the previous session derivation where I have already shown you how to get this ZP and Z values. Okay, Z is nothing but I by Y. Okay, so here for a rectangular section, you have to calculate a Z with respect to this. Then there is a plastic section modulus, that is this ZP. ZP is equal to A by 2. This is for, remember, Z is with respect to neutral axis and ZP is with respect to equal area axis. Remember that, equal area axis. Okay, so this formula will be Y1 plus Y2. Okay, this is the formula used to calculate the value of ZP. So for a rectangular section, the Z value is I by Y. So that if you calculate, you'll get it as B H square by 6, whereas for a ZP, that is the plastic modulus, we will get it as BH square by 4. BH square by 4 is nothing but the plastic modulus. So Y, the sigma Y's, FY, that is stress, okay, yield stress into plastic modulus will give you MP. So MY will be equal to 2 by 3 times the value of MP. Remember that, okay? So MY will be equal to 2 by 3 times the MP. So this is the value of MY. So for a bending moment diagram, so with respect to this bending moment diagram, MP by L by 2. So MP, okay, by L by 2. So this distance 1 equal to MY by MY. So till here, okay, MY. MY, that is L by L minus 2. So this distance you are required. So L by 2 minus x by 2. So that is what we are doing. Remember that. So what we are doing is that. So we require this length, okay? So from here to here we require. So how to get that value? L by 2 minus x by 2. So this is the value. So what we are going to divide first, MP divided by till here, half of the length, then MY divided by L by 2 minus x by 2. So this is what we have written here. Then rearranging the terms, okay, taking 2 common and rearranging. So 2, 2 will get cancelled. Okay, this will come here and this will come here. Remember that. That is interchanging we have done. Okay, rearranging. So L minus x MP into L into MY. So substituting the value of MY, what we have found out here, that is 2 by 3 MP. So once you substitute that, it will be like this. So L minus x MP and MP will get cancelled. So L minus x divided equal to 2 by 3 L. So what will be the value of x? X will be L by 2. So this will be your hinge length. Remember that, okay? So x will be L by 3. So L by 3 divided by 2. So the hinge length will be, therefore, the hinge length of a plastic zone is equal to 1 by 3 of the span. So this is the value of hinge length, okay, for a loading condition of point load. Remember that for a point load with a simply supported, the value of hinge length will be 1 by 3, that is span by 3. Whereas if we consider the hinge length for a plastic zone for a simply supported beam with the UDL, okay, uniformly distributed load, it is L by root 3, okay, same way you can derive this. So now what you have to consider, you have to consider that there is a load which is UDL, that is P per meter length, okay, per meter length, there is a UDL which is acting. So for that, you have to draw the bending moment diagram, which is nothing but a parabolic. So this is the bending moment diagram. Same thing if you go on deriving, which will be here, MP will be what? WL square by 8. So if you go on deriving like that itself, and then you have to equate this equation, then what will happen? The hinge length for a simply supported beam with a uniformly distributed load, that is nothing but UDL, you will get the hinge length as L by root 3. Okay, so in exam they might ask any of the conditions. Okay, they might ask you to find out the hinge length for a simply supported beam with a point load acting in the center, or a simply supported beam with the UDL acting at the center. But this is least probable cases. Okay, so just for your understanding, I have taught you what will be the hinge length. Remember that. Now let us go to a fully plastic section. So fully plastic section, as I mentioned earlier, the stress distribution diagram will be something like this. Remember that. So a fully plastic moment is the maximum moment of resistance of a fully yield cross section. Remember that. So here the whole section has yielded. The following assumptions are made to evaluate in the addition to the assumption made earlier while discussing the bending of the beams. So instability of a structure will not occur prior to attention of ultimate load. Remember that there won't be any instability. So in the elastic limit, in the limit state design, we ended up here, but we go further in the plastic zone. And remember that till it reaches this ultimate load, we don't say that there is any instability. The structure will be still be in a stable state. Once it exceeds this ultimate load, then we can say that there is some instability in it. Okay. So the connections are provided fully continuity such that plastic movement can be transmitted. So the connections between the beam to beam, or beam to column, okay, column. So those connections should be connected in a such a way that the plastic hinges gets transferred, okay, from beam to column or from one beam to another. So the loading is proportional. This is very important. The loading is proportional. All loads increases in a fixed proportion to one another. So remember that the load should be almost a uniform, okay, should be uniformly varying. Okay, it should not be like one load is going on increasing, other load is not increasing. It should not happen like that way. Remember that the load should be in a proper way. All the loads should be increasing in a constant manner. Okay, one load should be not be maximum, other load is decreasing. That thing should not happen. Remember that these are the three conditions. Okay, three assumptions what we assume while there is a plastic analysis. Remember that. So now let us see how to get the value of the plastic section modulus. Okay, this is ZP value. You already used this formula, right? A by 2. Okay, Y1 plus Y2, you have already used this formula to derive the section modulus for two cases, three cases, okay, for a rectangle, for a circle, and for a triangle. You have already found out the shape factor. For finding out the shape factor, you have used the formula, that is Zp. Okay, Zp equal to, that is the plastic modulus, A by 2, Y1 plus Y2. Now, how do we get this formula? Okay, let us see that. Okay, so shape factor is nothing but Zp by Z. So Zp value, this is the formula. So consider a fully yield beam section. So let me consider a fully yield beam section. Okay, the bending stress distribution will be rectangular as shown. So let me consider this one beam. Okay, a normal shape we are considering, and this is the how it looks like. Okay, weight is fully yielded, which means that there is Fy here and there is Fy here. Okay, so the C value will be Fy into A. See, so this is the area A1, okay, A1, whereas here area A2, okay, T, that is tension, Fy into A2. So the distance from the neutral axis or to the centroid of the above area will be Y1, to the neutral axis to the centroid of the below area, that is A2 area, is Y2. Okay, now let the nature of bending moment be sagging. So it will be a sagging bending moment like this, that the fibers above neutral axis are in compression. So whatever the fibers above, let us assume that it is in compression and the below is in tension. Okay, forces in compression, C equal to Fy A1. Okay, then T equal to Fy A2. So this is the forces in tension. In equilibrium condition exists, the forces in compression must be equal to what? Forces in tension. So C equal to T. So Fy A1 will be equal to Fy A2. So this is the equation now. So A1 will be equal to A2 will be equal to A by 2. So this is an equal section, right? So let us take that this A1 and A2 are equal, equally. Okay, why A1 and A2 are equal? Because we are considering it with respect to equal area axis, which divides the area into two equal parts. Remember that. That's why A1 equal to A2. So which is equal to A by 2. Remember that. So where A1 is the area of the section above neutral axis, A2 is the area of the section below neutral axis, and A is the area of cross section of the beam. So therefore, the neutral axis and the plastic section is sometimes equal, called as equal area axis. So here, both are considered as equal, the neutral axis as well as the equal area axis. This happens in a rectangle, okay? So in the previous session, we have seen regarding the rectangle where your neutral axis and the equal area axis are in the similar location, okay? Whereas if you consider a triangle, both are different. Remember that your neutral axis will be somewhere here and your equal axis will be somewhere in the other location. So in some cases, few cases, it will be equal. Now let us consider it for a rectangle case and let us complete the derivation. Once we consider it as a rectangle, what will happen? The neutral axis and the equal area axis will be in the similar location, which means that the A1 value will be equal to A2 value, which is equal to total area divided by 2. So the two forces, the tensile and compressive forces, form a couple to resist the movement. So as you can see from this sketch, okay? So from this sketch, what is this? This is one force, Fy into A2, whereas A2 will be what? A by 2. Remember that A2 will become what? A by 2. So your tension force will be equal to what? Fy into A by 2. And here, compressive force will be what? Fy into A by 2. So the force values are same. So both the force values are same. And there is a distance. This is the perpendicular distance, which is called as a lever arm. Okay, so with respect to this lever arm, Y1 plus Y2, this will try to rotate. Okay, with respect to this point, there will be a rotation, okay, which is nothing but a couple. Okay, so couple action is taking place. So here, My will be equal to Fy into A1 into Y1. So MP, remember that it is Fy for a compression, let us take first Fy into A1. This perpendicular distance is how much? That is Y1. Okay, movement with respect to this point. Okay, Fy A1 and the perpendicular distance Y1. With respect to T, it is Fy A2 into Y2. So that is what is written here. And substituting the value of A1, that is A by 2, and substituting the value of A2, that is again A by 2. So MP equal to Fy A by 2 Y1 plus Y2. So MP equal to what? Y Fy into Zp. So Zp is what? Plastic section modulus. So Zp is written as A2. Now we already know that, right? MP equal to Fy into Zp. That is the plastic modulus. So plastic modulus is now this part. That is A2, A by 2, Y1 plus Y2. So this is how we derive this formula for Zp. Okay, Zp equal to plastic modulus of the section A by 2, Y1 plus Y2. Y1 and Y2 are the distance of center of gravity of area above and below the neutral axis. Okay, so this is how we derive that formula. Remember that. Now, this is what is happening. So first, yielding at the top section will be taking place. Okay, Fy will be reached. Once that, the inner next fiber will be yielding. So like that way, it will be going on till the full plastic condition is reached. Okay. So your value of shape factor MP equal S equal to MP by MY or ZP by Z. So how to calculate the section modulus? That is I by Y, remember. And ZP will be equal to what? Plastic modulus will be equal to A by 2, Y1 plus Y2. Okay. So this is the formulas. Now let us solve the problem. So hope that you people are having the notebook with you. Okay. So and a calci. So now let us find out one by one the values. Okay. So are you people there? Okay. Now you people have to write down the answers by solving this, and in the chat box you people have to write the answers. Okay. So based on that your attendance will be given. Remember that. So make sure you people write the answers. I will write questions I will be asking. For that, with respect to that, your people have to write the answers. So let us see what we have to find out here. So calculate the shape factor. So we have to find out the value of S for a symmetrical S section as shown in this figure below. So sigma Y value, that is the yield value, stress at the yield, that is nothing but Fy itself, 250 megapascal. Calculate the value of MP, not just the value of shape factor. We have to find out the value of MP. What is the value of MP? MP is nothing but sigma Y into ZP, right? So let us see what is this I section is given. So first thing, what we need to find out? We need to find out two things, okay? S and MP, okay? Shape factor, S is what? MP. Shape factor is what? Shape factor is nothing but Zp by Z. Okay, so Zp is what? Zp is equal to A by 2, okay, and Y1 plus Y2. Okay, so this is one. Then what is Z? Z equal to I by A. Okay, I by A. Sorry, I by Y. Sorry, I by Y. I by Y. So what is MP? MP equal to plastic moment. Plastic moment equal to sigma Y. Okay. Into Zp. Okay, now these things you have to find out. Let us find out one by one. So for this symmetrical section, how to find out the value of I? So you can find out the value of I. So this is a symmetrical section. 100, 100 is the flange width. Okay, the web width is 230 and the web thickness is 20 mm. The flange thickness is 10 mm. Here also it is 10 mm. So how to find out the value of first, let us find out the values of Z. Z equal to I by Y. So what is the value of Y now? Yes, anyone who can unmute yourself and say, what is the value of I? Sorry, what is the value of Y? Sorry. What is the value of Y in this sketch? What is the value of Y? Yes, anyone? Y value in with respect to anything from the bottom or the top. Okay, with respect to bottom, if I consider, what is the value of Y? Where will be your neutral axis lies?
Yes, where will be your neutral axis lies? What is the value of Y? This is a symmetrical section, right? So till here it is 10. So what will be it? Yes, anyone?
Yes, what will be the value of Y? Easiest to the first Y. Y value.
Are you people at least writing in the chat box? If you can write it in the chat box also, it's fine. What is the value of Y in this condition? Y n for a symmetrical section. Yes. So at least some one person has at least written. So if I start wasting time for a simple questions, then it will be a lot of time waste. So let me easily say, okay.
125, sir.
Okay. So how to get that 125? So till here it is 10. So 10 plus 10 plus 230 will be 250. So from bottom or the top, if you want to consider the value of y, that will be equal to 125. So this is the first thing what you have found out. So what we got the value of y, so that is 125. Next, let us find out the value of I. So how to get the value of I? So let me consider this as complete one rectangular section. Okay. This has one rectangular section. Okay. So what is the formula to find out the value of I for a rectangular section? It is BD cube by 12, right? So this is the formula. So let me apply that. So what is the value of B? B value is 100. So B value is 100 into D value. D value is how much? 10 plus 230 plus 10, that is 250 cube. 250 cube divided by 12. Now let us subtract this part. Now e part na subtract marbeku. So we are considering it as a rectangle, then we have to minus this two rectangles. Okay, so minus 2 into the two part. So how much is this value now? So this till here it is 100. Okay, 100 minus 20, it is 80. 80 divided by 2 will give you this part as 40. Okay, that is 40 now. 40 into 230 cube. 230 cube divided by 12. Yes, someone use your calci and get me this value. What will be this value? So make sure you try to solve it. Okay, Rahul, Kristen, you people also should say the values. Remember that. So how much is this value? So that value will be equal to 4.905 9 to 10 to the power of 7 mm to the power of 4. This is the value. So your z will be ixx by y maximum. So ixx will be equal to 4.9095 into 10 to the power of 7 divided by 125. This will be your value. Okay, so it will be in 10 to the power of 5. Don't forget these things. Okay, your I value will be huge. That's why your value of Z will be in 10 to the power of 5 or 10 to the power of 4. Remember that. 3.927 into 10 to the power of 5 mm cube. So section modulus is done. Now what about the next part? That is nothing but the ZP. So ZP is what? A by 2 Y1 plus Y2. This is with respect to equal area axis. Okay, equal area axis is nothing but which divides this section into equal areas, right? So where is your equal area axis lies now? So equal area axis also lies here itself. So this is nothing but your neutral axis, as well as that is xx is the neutral axis, whereas this line itself is your equal area axis, which means that if this line divides the section into two equal parts. Okay, so this is the condition now. So now what we need to find out? We need to find out the center of gravity of the section. So there are two center of gravity. One for this rectangle, that is in the web. Second one is still here. Okay, so these are the two y1, y2 we required. And we multiply with 2 so that we can get the other side also. So let us see that. So ZP equal to A by 2 y1 plus y2. So substituting the condition that y1 and y2 are same. Yes, right? So y1 and y2 are same because it is a symmetric section. Okay, in the above condition we get that ZP equal to 2A y1 plus this, and 2 gets cancelled. So ZP will be equal to A into y1 bar. So now A into y1 bar is fine. So A into y1 will be for two cases. One is for this web case, another one is for this flange case. Same thing was we have to should have been done here also. One is for the web case, another one was for the flange case. But instead what we done,
we just made sure that we multiplied it 2 to neglect this part. Remember that, okay? That is what we have done here, okay? So we have considered this and we have multiplied with 2. Okay, that 2 get cancelled and this is what it is. Now, what will be this y1? So y1 will be the distance from this equal area to till here, to the centroid of this web part. Then to the centroid of this next flange part. Now, what will be this value, anyone, till this flange? You people have to write down that value from the equal area axis till the centroid of this flange. What will be that distance? If you write down this, you will get 1 marks. Sorry, you will get the 10 marks for your assignments. Okay, first assignment in a 10 marks kodtini. If you write down only first 2 peoples, okay, you have to write down the value of this y1 from the equal area axis till this centroid of the flange. Yes, have you people written down? Assignment in a 10 marks is there. So yes. So that what is written is correct. So from here to here, total will be 125. So your this length y1 will be 120. Then what will be the centroid till here? It will be this 230 divided by 2. That is from, sorry, 230 divided by 2, which will be equal to, how much will be 230 divided by 2? 23 divided by 2, it is
115.
Then that is divided by 2 again. So that will be equal to 57.5 till the centroid of this part, 57.5. So that is this next what they have written. See here, we have to draw this sketch again. For remember that for equal area axis, we have to draw the sketch again. Remember that. So this is the symmetrical axis. This is your neutral axis. So 115. Again, 115 divided by 2 we have to do to get the value of y2. Okay, till here it will be y1. So the y1 value what you have people have written is correct, 120. And y2 is what is something around how much? 57.5. So those things is been substituted here. Okay. So a1 y1 100 into 10. Okay. Into 120. So here the 2 is kept constant. Okay. So these things they have kept constant. So into 120 plus 115 into 20 into 115 by 2. So this is what they have done, 115. So this is 115, okay? 115 into 20, the thickness, divide into 115 divided by 2. That is 57 point something. So we'll get the value of ZP. Remember, don't forget to multiply with this 2, okay? So 2 times, because we have to consider the down part also, we have considered only the above the equal area axis, but we have to consider the down portion also. So that ZP value will be equal to 5.045 into 10 to the power of 5 mm cube. So this is the value of ZP. Now the last thing, the shape factor will be ZP by Z. So ZP value is 5.045 into 10 to the power of 5. Okay, that is the value of ZP. And your value of Z is 3.927. So 3.927 into 10 to the power of 5. So 10 to the power of 5 and 10 to the power of 5 get cancelled. So 5 divided by something around 3. So remember that your shape factor should be greater than 1 in all cases. Okay. So your shape factor will be equal to 1.285. Okay. The shape factor will be equal to 1.285. And don't stop the problem here itself. Most of you people will stop the problem here itself. So read the question correctly, because in the question they have asked you the value of MP also. Okay. They have asked you the value of MP also. So what is your value of MP? MP value is nothing but sigma y into ZP. So sigma y, that is 250 yield stress into the ZP value, which you have found out here, which will be equal to 112.6125 into 10 to the power of 7. It should be 10 to the power of 7. Okay. The number should come up. newton per mm. So this is the value of plastic moment. Okay, so here your problem ends. So let us solve one more problem in this session. Now let us go for a T section. Okay, so for a T section, let us find out first thing. Let us go one by one. So first, what is the value of y? Yes, anyone? What is the value of y in this case? What is the value of y in this case? So here, how can you find out the value of y? Using the formula a1y1 plus a2y2. So using this formula, we have to find out a1 by a2. So using this formula, we have to find out the value of y1. So that is the first step. Then how to find out the value of I? I equal to what? B d cube by 12 plus a y1 square. So using this formula, you have to find out the value of I. Okay, there are two sections. So B1, D1. So one is the flange section, one is the web section. Okay, so area A1. So let me consider this as A1. Okay, Y1. Then again, B2 d cube divided by 12 plus A2 Y2 whole square. So using this formula, you have to find out the with respect to the second part. Okay, so this is how it looks like. Determine the shape factor for T section. Okay, so this is the question. Only we need to find out the value of S. Okay, so first thing what we have to do, we have to find out this Y value. Okay, so these things will not be given in a question. The question will be something like this. So we have to consider this first thing. We have to find out what will be the depth of the neutral axis from the bottom. Try to find out with respect to bottom itself. That is nothing but your reference axis. So your reference axis, try to consider it in the bottom. With respect to this, what will be the value of y bar? So that is nothing but the centroidal distance. Okay, so that, how to calculate that value? So y bar equal to a1 y1 plus a2 y2 divided by a1 plus a2. So a1 is 120 into 10. So y1 is from here it will start. Okay, 110 plus 10 by 2, that is 115. So 110 divided by 110 divided by 2, that is 55. Okay, 110, this value 110 divided by 2 will give you the distance. So that is 55 divided by 120 into 10, area 110 into 10. So this is the flange width, flange area. This is the web area. So it will be 86.3 mm. So from here bottom, it is 86.3. So from the top, it is 33.7. So now y maximum will be what? Y maximum will be the maximum of these two. So that is nothing but by 86.3 mm. So y maximum you have already found out. Next, what we need to find out, I. So I, using the same form, this formula what I have written here, you can find out. So first, 120 into 10 cube. So this is the width and this is the depth. Okay, so therefore it will be 120 into 10 cube. Remember that 10 cube divided by 12 plus 120 into 10. Now, what will be this distance? You have to find out. Okay, so what will be that distance? So that is nothing but 33.7. So here 33.7 minus this part, that is 10 by 2, that is nothing but 5. So 33.7 minus 5 whole square plus, again, now comes the second part, this part. Okay, so 10 is the width of the web into 110 cube divided by 12, then plus 10 into 110 into, now you have to find out this distance, that is 86.3 minus 110 divided by 2, that is 55. 86.3 minus 55, okay, whole square. So that IXX value will be equal to 31.885237 mm to the power of 4. So ZXX will be equal to IXX divided by Y max. So that is equal to this IXX value, okay, divided by 86.3, you will get it as this much, 36,912.21 mm³. So don't forget to write down the units. So for a section modulus or for plastic modulus, whenever you say modulus, the value will be in mm³. Whenever you say I, that is modulus of inertia, we say it as mm to the power of 4. Okay, y value will be in mm. So most of the problems will be in mm itself. Remember that. Why? Because all this steel section, whatever we use in the steel tables, will be in mm. Remember that. So net, now one part is done. Now we have to find out the value of zp, right? So let yp, so here in the sketch you can see, be the height from the bottom at which the plastic moment of inertia occurs. Now let us think that with respect to this reference axis, okay, mn is your reference axis. Now let me assume that we are, our equal area axis lies in the plunge part, okay? It might lies in the web part also, it's fine. For our easiness, what we do is that we assume that this equal area axis lies in the flange. Okay, here it lies. Now let us find out the value of yp, okay, with respect to this reference axis. So how to calculate that? So to calculate that, what will we do is that this area, okay, let me shade this area. Okay, this is the shaded area. Okay, this is the total area. Now we consider 120 into 120 minus yp, so that is the total. Okay, 110 plus 10, 120 minus this yp will get you this part. Remember that. Okay, now we will getting what? 120 into yp1, so this is nothing but what? 120 minus yp is what? yp1. So that is the area of the shaded part. Now here what I have shaded here, remember that, will be equal to what? It will be equal to this total area divided by 2. That is what it does, right? So your equal area axis, what it does, it divides this section into two equal areas. Okay, so for that, what we have to do, we have to divide it by this whole area. So whole area will be what? 120 into 10 plus 110 into this 10 divided by 2. So what will be your value of yp? Yp will be equal to 1200 plus 110 divided by 2 into 120, okay, plus 120. So this finally will be equal to 110.42, which is greater than 100. Which is greater than 100 means what? Whatever we have assumed, that equal area axis lies in the flange. If you could have asked me, sir, what happens if it is less than 100, right? If it is less than 110, which means that this equal area axis lies in this part, web part. Okay, now it is greater than 110. That's why what we have assumed, that this equal area axis lies in the flange part, right? That assumption is correct. Remember that. So here is your equal area axis. Okay, so this is your value of yp. So yp1 will be 120 minus 110.42, that is 9.58. So this value will be 9.58. Okay, so what is the now zp? Zp equal to, now let us see one by one how they have taken the value of zp. Remember, now we are not using the formula that we have used till now. That is equal to zp by a by 2 plus y1 plus y2. This formula we are not using now. Okay, because instead of that, we have found out the value of yp, right? Instead of that, we can easily do in one more method. That is what I'm doing now. Okay, so what they have done? So 120, so this is the value, plus into yp1 by 2 whole square. So this value, yp1 divided by 2, this is the value. Okay, plus 120 into 10 into, so 120 into 10, okay, minus this yp1 whole square divided by 2. Okay, this is how we have done. So this is nothing but your area. Okay, this is the area. Now instead of directly taking and doing for a whole section together, what we have done, we are doing it separately. So let us take this section first. Okay, so what is the section value? That is 120 into yp1 divided by 2. So this is the value of area. Okay, this is the value of area. So yp1 whole square divided by 2, that is the value of area. Now plus the centroidal distance we have to consider, 120 into 10 minus yp1 whole square divided by 2 plus, now that bottom part, that is this web part. Okay, So for web part, the bottom part, that is 110 into 10 yp minus 110 by 2 whole square. So equal to, when we substitute this yp one for in the equation, you will get the value of zp section modulus equal to this much. Okay, so it is 9,66,479.17 mm to the power of cube. So the shape factor for this type of T section will be 1.8. Okay, so this T section, the value of this shape factor will be 1.8. So I'm hopeful that you people have understood these things. Okay, so if you don't have any doubts, you can ask me. Okay, you can ask me now itself. You can unmute yourself. Okay, you can unmute yourself and you can ask. So here, so let me make you more clear. So remember, 120, this value, into y1 by 2 whole square, okay, plus 120 into 10 minus, so this 10 distance, 10 minus y1, so we'll cover from here to here, okay, whole square by 2, then 110 into 10, 110 this value into this 10, yp, that is this, minus this distance, we have to first, this is the area, remember that this is the area part. Now, minus the distance y, yp minus 110 by 2, that is 55 whole square. That is how they have done, okay, to get the value of zp. So, s equal to zp by z, which is equal to 1.8. So, this is the value. So, next, this is your assignment, okay. First assignment, few problems. Next few problems will be given in the after few session. Okay, this is just the starting of the assignment. Two problems. Okay, now what you people need to do is that you have to find the shape factor for a diamond section. Okay, this is the diamond section. Okay, this is how it looks like. Even the diamond section can be shown in this manner. Okay, even if the diamond section is shown in this manner, the shape factor will remains the same. Okay, so the shape factor for a diamond is equal to 2. Okay, so you have to prove that the shape factor will be equal to 2. Okay, now we have to find for this, just find out me the shape factor, which is equal to 2 for a diamond section. Okay, if the diamond section is arranged in this manner also, the shape factor will remain same. Okay, so you have to prove this. And here, remember that the terms, whatever I have given here, use those terms itself. Okay, so this is your first problem. And the second problem is, for an asymmetrical I section, you people have to find the shape factor. So this is your second question. Okay, now who have written the answers correctly in the chat box regarding that y1? So you three people need not to do that. Okay, so that is Dhananjay first, three people I have said. So Dhananjay, Nivedita and Rashmita, you three people need not solve these problems. Okay, so if you want, you can solve. And remember, in exam, lot of times they have asked these types of problems, the diamond section or this asymmetrical I section. So if you solve, it's well and good. Okay, so if you have any doubts, you people can ask. If you don't have any doubts, you can write it down, okay sir, in the chat box, and you can leave the session. Okay, if you need any doubts, you have to write down for your attendance, write down okay sir in your chat box. And you can leave the session. If you have any doubts, you can ask me. Yes, do you people have any doubts regarding how to calculate the shape factor for any other section rather than this standard section? If you have any doubts, you can ask. Yes.